Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that he shall also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall reap of the flesh corruption. And he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we will reap if we do not faint. Time for lunch. No, just a reminder to eat lunch.
Oh, okay.
It was set for yesterday. You might take this time just to check yours. Okay. All right. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we do not faint. And as we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them that are of the household of faith. Going back again, let's take a peek. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7 is our text this morning. Paul, as you recall when we got to the Galatians, was dealing with a problem with the Galatians. Let me turn this on. The Galatians wanted to go back to Judaism, something that most of them really knew nothing about. But Judaism had pomp. Judaism had this formalism to it that looked really good. You'd see these fellas with all of their gold in their temples, their long robes, their fancy dress. You were down here, they were up there. I mean, wow, it was impressive. When I was growing up as a child, I grew up in the Roman church. And the same thing, you had the priest high and lifted up here, all the gold. We had the golden tabernacle, we had golden sticks, three candlesticks on this side, three candlesticks on that side, two candelabras. And whenever God was in the house, those candles on either side of the tabernacle were lit. And if God was gone, those candles were unlit. So in the morning when the priest walks in, you'd see him walking in holding this little box thing, right? When he comes in, the altar boys come with him and they'll light those two candles next to it so that you and I know that Jesus just entered the house. We brought him in this box. Most people still want to keep God in a box. We want God over here. When we need him, we go open the box and say, God, do this for me. And we close the box and we blow out the candles and we're not bothered by him. Don't be deceived. God doesn't live in a box. God is not mocked. Most of life, most of the life of this world is spent in making mockery of God. Most people will take this precious gift, the blood of Jesus Christ, and laugh at it. As though God has nothing to say. Or, you know what? I don't care what the book says. I think. That's what everybody says. You know, it's kind of disheartening for those of us who actually went to school to learn. And then you find out I didn't need any Bible college because everybody knows more than I do already. Because they think. Wow, what do you think? I don't? You know, it's like, well, I think, well, I know, but people who have never opened this book will tell you what they think about it. Never read a page, don't know the names of the apostles, couldn't tell you what day of the week they met, nothing about them. Yet they'll say, well, all of a sudden their knowledge is equal to the knowledge of God and surpasses it even. Because this is what I think. They take this book, they take this sacrifice and they add it to the pile of religion. And everybody can have their own. That's guaranteed under the Constitution. You can go out and make up your own. A lot of people do it. And if you make it hard, difficult and expensive, you'll get a following. Millions will follow you. See, my problem, I'm giving it all away. Nobody wants to come to something that's free. Everybody, because you can't brag about something you went to for free, something you got for free. Because free isn't worth anything, is it? We all like to brag. We want people to think we got a good deal, but we still want them to know we paid a good price on it. If I was to have a big diamond ring, it wouldn't mean anything if I told you I spent a buck and a half for this diamond. You'd say, come on, cut glass. Oh, but I mean, I don't care how much it sparkles. Once I told you I got it for a dollar and a half, you don't care anymore, right? If I told you this diamond ring over here cost $1 million, you'd all want to look at it because it cost $1 million. See, it became important because it cost money. That's how we value things in this world. That's why God gets mocked. Because God freely gave. Now, if he was smart like the world, he would charge them. But he doesn't. I was watching this program about Scientology. And the lady who was a Scientologist comes out now and she's telling some of the problems of Scientology. You know, the average Scientologist, it will cost them $250,000 in books alone by the time they get to whatever level they're trying to get to. Now, there's a lot of Scientologists because everybody wants to say, I am holier than you. I spent $250,000 to get holy. They own, Lord knows, they got so much money, billions and billions and billions of dollars. They buy empty buildings, empty warehouses, because they can't stockpile this money. They got to spend it, right? So they buy more buildings. They are buying up Florida. You go to Hemet. It's odd that their world center, their worldwide thing is, and all of the people in charge got these mansions, and they own like most of Hemet out there. It's crazy. Crazy. Why? Because some guy said, I don't care what God says. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to make myself a God. L. Ron Hubbard wrote a book. And in it, he laid out how you could become a God like him. Now, the problem was L. Ron Hubbard died of cancer. Too much alcohol, too much tobacco. Weakened his body, cancer sets in. When he died, they had to try to figure out, because L. Ron Hubbard was going to become a spirit. And he was going to do it right in front of our face. When you get holier and holier and holier, suddenly you just become light itself, right? Unfortunately, he died and never got to that top level. So they had to figure out how to explain this to their people real quickly. Craziness. So they said, he left his body, and they're all waiting for him to come back. Wonder where they got that idea from. But we got that idea for free. It didn't cost me $250,000. That's why they have so much money. All those millions of people they bring in. You don't get to be the next spirit. You don't get to be holier unless you buy the books. And then you don't get to the next. They got 30. Originally, I guess it started out with 9 levels, and now they got 39 levels. And they'll make a 40th one, because when you reach this level, they got to still get money from you. And so they keep making new levels of holiness so that you keep buying the books that these guys write. It's crazy. Catholic Church, billions and billions and billions of dollars. Because they have high and lifted up, they got gold everywhere. It looks good to the eye. Men are deceived. Why? Because we go by what we see. And so if you see this marvelous facade, if you see a beautiful building decked in gold, you figure that's success. When you go to, you used to have to go to Salt Lake City, but you don't have to go that far anymore. You can go down over here, down the coast, heading towards San Diego. Starts with a LA something or other. Fancy town down there. But you go there and you'll see their white temple just off the 5 freeway. when you're heading toward San Diego. I'll think of it in a minute. You watch. I'll get it. It's one of them coast.
La Jolla.
La Jolla. There you go, where all the rich folks live. And you get down to La Jolla and you see this beautiful, beautiful white structure. Cost millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars. And they too have a way that you can come in and you can get holier and holier and holier and holier. And when you get holy enough, you will become a God yourself. What God is, you will become. And when you can offer to people, they don't care what it costs, so long as they get to be a God someday, they'll pay the price. And you go in and they have beautiful buildings, beautiful structures. Theirs are always the nicest in town. You look for the nicest church, it's going to be a Mormon church, I'll guarantee you that. They are well manicured, they are beautiful. You have to buy their books, you have to get their understanding, you have to pay their price. See, that's where we're losing it, folks. We're giving all this stuff away for free. Be not deceived. But see, people like to deceive themselves. Why? Because they like to see. That's the whole point. They want to see. God is not mocked. For whatsoever man sows, that will he also reap. Let's consider these words now here for just a moment. First of all, we have an unalterable law. The law of reciprocity, the law of sowing and reaping. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. You know, even in the Christian church, we teach people to be worldly. We bribe them. You know how preachers get you to give money in the offering tray? They promise if you give, God will give you more. We appeal to your greed. Go ahead, turn on the TV, watch any of them preachers out there, and when they ask you for a dollar, they're going to promise that you are going to get 10 times as much. You send me $1,000, God will give you back $10,000. I'm not asking you to sacrifice and suffer for Jesus Christ. He's not worth it. Who is worth it? You are. You're worth it. If you give $1,000, you will get $10,000 in this life. Right now, today, you get a brand new car, a brand new house. You might as well get a brand new wife or a brand new husband to go with it. That's what the world is offering. It's offering you the pleasing of the flesh. So in the church itself, we're driven by greed. But see, there's an unalterable law that whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. And we twist that to guarantee you something that God never promised. There are two parts to all of this, if you would. There is in any sowing action, of course, you have to have two items. And the first item is the seed. The seed comes into play here. Whatsoever man sowed, that's his seed. I'm a farmer. And I want to grow corn. So I go to the feed store and I say to the guy, what's your cheapest seed? The guy said, well, wheat's pretty cheap. All right, give me a bag of wheat seeds. Yeah, I thought you wanted to grow corn. Yeah, but corn seeds are a little more. They're like three times as much as wheat seeds. So I'll sow these wheat seeds, and when they grow up, they will become corn. Because I don't care what God said. It doesn't matter what the law is. It only matters what I want. And I want these to be corn when they grow up. I want to get into the pearly gates. I want to spend my time with God. So guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to make myself into a God instead. That way, listen, why wait to heaven to spend time with God? If I make myself a God, I get to start spending time with Him today. See how foolish it is? I want to grow corn, so I'm going to cast wheat because it's cheaper. It's easier. And then I'll just pray like crazy that at the end I get corn. I'm telling you, I could pray all day long and I ain't going to get corn at the end of the day because I planted wheat. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. We as church people, the church is at fault because we have taught our people to be greedy. We have taught our people to be fleshly. We have taught ourselves to be selfish. It's all about me. And we wonder how come the church is no longer a godly place. Why righteousness does not rule in our land. Righteousness doesn't rule in the church. How can it possibly rule in the land? Where we have spent years and decades teaching our people to be greedy, to hold on to what you can, to get all you can, and to keep it. Why? Because we value wealth like everybody else. We see good things. We justify ourselves based on what we see. We want to go to the prettiest church in town. We want to go to the best looking church. Oh, we don't care that they're wolves in sheep's clothing. We don't care that inwardly they're gross and grotesque. We don't care that they're not serving God. We just want them to look like they are. That's what we have become because we have deceived ourselves. See, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. We're out there sowing all of that wheat and asking God to give us corn. And it isn't working very well, is it? We have got to get back to spending the price. It costs to be a godly person. There is time spent in reading God's word. There is time spent in praying to Almighty God. There is time spent in exercise of holy things. We wonder what happened to our children and how come they're all gone. And how come the second and third generation aren't growing up in the church? Because we taught them the church was nothing. This world was everything. Look at what you see. And we trained our children to be good seers. We trained our children to go after the things of the flesh. We wanted our kids in the same schools that the world wanted their kids in so they would learn the same things that the worldly kids did. And then we wonder how come they grew up like worldly kids. This is unalterable. God said this. Doesn't change. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. The most precious seed you and I could ever bear is the Word of God. The seed that will change our lives is the Word of God, but we never pick it up. We never sow it into our life. We never take the time to read it. We never let it soak in and settle down and become real. We never read it like we should follow it. We always read the book like it's a good book. We never read it like it's a book that should change us when we're done. I don't care how many times I've read that chapter, when I read it again, it ought to still be changing me. Unless, of course, like some of you, I have reached perfection. Up until that time, every time I read God's word, it should still be changing me and changing me and changing me and changing me. Because that's what he said. Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. I sow to this flesh, I reap corruption. Oh, I may have invested in this world and I may be wealthy in this world's goods, but when I close my eyes in death, all that this world has stays in this world, including this flesh. This body will never leave this plane. When you lay me down in that box, that's it. That's where I'm staying. When I get to heaven, I will get a new glorified body. One, this body wasn't made for heaven. I'll receive a body that is made when I get there. Nothing of this old world, nothing of this old world makes it to the other side. But yet we've invested our entire life into this, which doesn't matter. We've trained ourselves. The seeds are our thoughts. And our thoughts come out in two ways, in our words and in our deeds. I'm cultivating the thoughts that God would want me to have. And if that's true, then you should see me doing the things that Jesus did and saying the things that Jesus did. I'm often getting after people at work because they profess Christianity, but they talk, and I apologize to all sailors for saying this, they talk worse than a drunken sailor. Every word is foul. And then they will come by and they'll see me read my Bible or see me praying. They'll sit down and say, oh, I'm a Christian too. Mm-hmm. Really? Last time I heard, salt water and fresh water don't come out of the same fountain. I heard you over there talking. Now you want to sit over here and talk about Jesus with that same filthy mouth? Don't think so.
You better check that out, son. You better check that out. They'll get a little bit mad, but
that does them good. Why? Whatsoever man soweth, that's actually, they're reaping, they're sowing to the flesh, they're reaping from the flesh. Are they changing people's lives? Are they winning people? No. They're just making it harder for me. You know, when I was a young man and I was out there trying to win people to Jesus, they would always point to some fallen Christian. Somebody who professed Christianity but never lived up to it. And when I would come and try to witness to people, they'd say, oh, well, so-and-so used to say that same stuff. Now he's like the biggest drunk on the whole ship. It's tough to outlive other people's testimonies. Because everybody just figures you're the same guy. And you'll be doing the same stuff. You know, when I began life as a Christian, a lot of the people that I started with are no longer around. They all went back to the world. Most of the fellows I went to Bible college with are no longer around. They went back to the ways of the world. Most of the folks we started with even here are gone. Why? Because they were sowing to the flesh. And so they reaped corruption. I said there were two things. Number one was the seed. The other is the soil. Remember what Jesus said? There was different kinds of soil, isn't there? If you're sowing to that self-centered part of you, even God's word will do you no good. You know how you could tell you're self-centered? Because when you read God's word, you're looking for a way to put somebody else down. You're looking to the word to prove that you're right and they're wrong. It's a way of settling your argument. Well, God said, and he's on my side. You ever notice everybody claims God? Civil War, Union and the Southern, both thanking God for being on their side. Boom. The Lord's on our side. Everybody thinks God's on their side, regardless of they're doing what God wants them to do or not. See, that's just how we think. We don't read this book. We don't find out what God wants and then do it. We do what we want and then tell God to get in line with it. Wrong soil. Look at this reminder that God gives us. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Be not deceived. You know, it's easy, as I said before, to deceive ourselves. We have so much what we call false expectations because we're in charge. You know, this last election cycle, I don't know how closely you watched it or not, but the news people deceived themselves. When the campaign started, the first thing they did is they wrote Trump off and said he's not even a serious candidate. Most of them said, we won't even report on him because he ain't going to last. They started out with a deception and they said, this woman over here, she's going to be crowned Queen of America. They knew it, they guaranteed it, so they didn't even bother to follow the election themselves. And they told this guy, you're gone. And they told this woman, you're already the president. Go ahead and get the gown and get everything up and ready. They had the champagne, they brought it in, they were all ready for the celebration because they were told over and over again, you're the winner, you're the loser, before the race even started. The media deceived itself, and then the election night came along and they said, what is going on here? How did this happen? It happened because you weren't interested in finding the truth. You were just interested in predicting what was going to happen and declaring what would happen. I could declare anything I want, doesn't make it true. I have to find out what God wants, because God's still in control of all things all the time. Be not deceived. Yet people run out headlong into deception. People are going to close their eyes in death and open their eyes in hell because they have deceived themselves. They had said God doesn't matter. There isn't a God. And then someday they're standing in front of him and, wow, you really do exist. Yes, I do. And this really was, the cross of Jesus Christ really was the way of salvation. And you rejected it when you rejected me. Can you imagine the looks? But my mom and dad said, wow, you're standing next to your mom and dad and you say, my mom and dad told me you didn't exist, and I believed my mom and dad? Go ahead, mom, dad, pay for it at that point. Be not deceived. See, that's a temptation. Self-deception is the biggest problem we serve. People are willing. Everybody wants news to always be good news, especially regarding themselves. So when somebody comes and says, you're the guaranteed winner, wow, great. You know what I'm going to do? I'm not going to go out and campaign as hard as I probably should because I'm already the winner. And this guy, poor sap, ain't got a chance. But that poor sap went and worked hard and long, day in and day out. People say he never slept. And then on election day, guess who got it? The guy who was not deceived by what he heard and what he saw, but rather worked for what he believed could be possible. People think because they're born in America, they have an inherited right to heaven. And we have to be careful that we don't further that in their thoughts and minds. Every man, every woman, my boys, my daughters don't get a free ticket. My niece doesn't get a free ticket to heaven just because she's related to me. When my cake goes to heaven and Jesus says, cake, why should I let you into heaven? Well, my dad was a preacher. Why, bless your heart. That doesn't work here. What? Your parents never told you to accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? No. They just assumed I was getting in because of dad. I don't care. Your dad's a nice guy, but he ain't that good, I'll tell you. My Becca walks up to heaven. St. Peter stands there and says, Becca, why should we let you into heaven? Because I'm related to Uncle Terry. Oh, marvelous guy. Love him to death, but sorry, that's not good enough. He barely squeaked himself by. You have to come through the blood of Jesus Christ. My son, Mikey, and Nano, and Lukey, and my daughters, Jaylene and Kaylee, they got to come through the blood. And guess what my grandchildren have to do? They have to come through the blood. They've got to come by faith in Jesus Christ. I can't afford to deceive myself. I can't afford to deceive them because I can't afford to deceive my grandkids. And trusting someday great-grandkids. There's a lot of folks I can't afford to fool. I can't fool my nieces and my nephews. I have to tell them the truth too. See, be not deceived. God is not mocked. If you didn't bother to read his book, that's not his fault. He gave it to you. You don't get to write another one. You don't get to claim like Mormonism, what I wrote once, I could write a second time and then write a completely different book. Doesn't work that way. This is the book. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. And you don't get to rewrite that statement. You don't get to make Jesus say things he didn't say. Because I don't care what you say, it doesn't change anything. In the eternal. God is, you know this word mocked right here? It means to turn your nose up at God. You heard the phrase turn your nose up? That literally, this word that we have for mocked comes from the Greek anywhere, it comes from the word nose. The idea of wrinkling or turning up your nose at somebody. Yeah. I'm a little bit better than you. And we say that to God all the time. Hundreds of ways every day. We turn our nose up at God. Because we know a little bit better than He does, don't we? If God was only as clever as me. You ever notice how many times we say, if I was God, I would do it like this? Turn the nose up at Him. We just mocked Him.
We have to be careful so we can teach others to be careful. We cannot deceive ourselves. Be not deceived. God is not mocked.
Doesn't change. People will stand before Him one day and realize that they were wrong about everything they thought and said and did. And He leaves us with this word of encouragement when we get down. Be not weary in well-doing. See, because it's hard, isn't it? We look around and how come those false churches I was telling you about, those are the big rich churches. They got all the people and all the money. And it's hard for us someday to sit there and say, well, you know what? Why should we keep on the honest path? It doesn't pay. Honesty doesn't, that's what they teach our kids in college now. Honesty doesn't pay in business. You have to cheat. That's why if you were a member of Wells Fargo, Wells Fargo was creating false accounts. They were just making up accounts. Just making stuff up. Cooking the books. They got in trouble. It cost them hundreds of millions of dollars. Government said, where's all these people at? Oh, they don't really exist, but we figure if we made their names up, we could get government promises back on them. I can't really understand what the scheme was completely, but it had to do with bilking the government out of money using false people that didn't exist. Where'd they learn that? They learned that in business school. Where did they learn that? Oh, probably that business professor probably learned it in some Bible college somewhere. Or in his church, when the preacher said, if you give me a dollar, God will give you 10. If you give me 10, God will give you 100. If you give me 100, God will give you 1,000. You give me 1,000, God will give you 10,000. You want to be rich? Then you go out, you drain your account, and you give it to me. And God will give you 10 times as much. Maybe 100 times as much. Guess who gets rich in that congregation? Yeah. So I have an air-conditioned doghouse, and I drive around in a gold car. Well, you're still in some Volkswagen being held together with Band-Aids and baling wire. And that guy thinks he's making it into heaven? I guarantee he never see the place. It's not what you know. Hey, I just came up with a new phrase. It's not what you know, it's what you sow. Oh, that's good. That's probably a Jerry Osbourne-ism right there. I'm going to write that one down. It's not what you know, it's what you sow. That's important. That's what makes you. That's what changes you. I can have all kinds of good thoughts, but I never carry them out. What good does that do me? It's not what I know, it's not what I think I should do, it's what I've actually done. You ever notice how God asks that we accomplish things with our faith? If there's no tangible evidence left behind on your faith, then it doesn't work. You're sitting on faith right now. There was a time when these pews didn't exist and people believed for them. Then there were times when these pews got real ratty looking and a few folks believed for some new coverings on them. There was a time when the carpet on this place was falling apart. You could literally, we could stand here and look at all the threads being pulled apart. Remember how bad that floor looked? And you're walking on someone's faith every time you come into this building. It's all faith. There is something physical left behind by your faith. If there isn't, then you really don't have any faith. There should be something physical left behind to to evidence your faith. Or you didn't really have any. You didn't step out and do. Oh, you may have thought, you know what? I should do this for God. Someday I will do this for God. But until you actually accomplish it, it doesn't count. That's what he's telling us. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Be not weary in well-doing. For in due season, see, not necessarily in this lifetime. That's what we like to tell everybody. We look around and we say, hey, preacher, if your faith was so great, how come you're not a rich man? You should see the pile of money I got up there. Because Jesus said, lay not up treasures in this world where moth and rust and thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. But you know what the problem with laying up treasure in heaven is? You have to live in a pretty lousy house down here. And most of us in America, there are fewer people saving money than there are those who are using credit cards. You know why we like credit cards? Because I can get what I can't afford. I take that plastic card, swipe it, and that thing that I wanted is mine today. I can't pay for it, but I got it. I can't afford it, but look at me. And then in a couple of years, look at me. I got all this debt. I owe. So off to work I go. And if we had just put a couple of bucks in the bank, we wouldn't feel so bad. But we have taught ourselves to have it right now. So we don't want to lay up for ourselves in store in heaven. We want it down here. And the church bought into that by telling its people, don't worry about there, why not have it here? Did you know God wanted you to be rich today? Did you know that God wants you to be the most wealthy person on your block? Tell you what you do. Drain out your bank account. You get that $100,000 you've been saving for retirement. Give it to me now. God will give you $1 million. Now, does it bother me that God didn't give you? No, because I can blame him. Hey, I'm sorry. It was faith, and you apparently didn't have any. I gave you my $100,000. Yeah, but apparently God wasn't on your side. I can't do anything about it. I already spent your money. See that air-conditioned doghouse over there? Those things aren't cheap. Yeah. And that's what the church has become. And it's easy for us to become weary in well-doing. Because it doesn't seem like it's working. Sometimes it seems like I'm the only one, or you're the only one that's still believing that old stuff. Nobody else is believing in Jesus anymore. Why do I have to? My mother would say, if everybody jumped off a cliff, would you do it too? Well, yeah, if it looks like fun. Jesus said, when I come, will I even find faith? Not let alone people doing anything, will I even find faith itself, the thing that you're supposed to believe in, will I even find that in existence when I come? So long as I'm alive, he will. The good thing about being a loner is you don't care what other people do and say. As long as I know what he wants me to do, I'll do it. Like I tell you, on Sunday morning, when the second person walks in that door, I'm a happy camper because Jesus came in with them. Because his promise is if two or three. I don't have to have 10,000 people in this building in order to feel the presence of God. As soon as the second person came in. And guess what? When I got here, my wife was over there playing the piano and Mikey was standing next to her singing. I knew Jesus was already in the building. He got here a little bit early. So I got here a little bit early to be with him. Oh, I wouldn't object if 10,000 people were here. Probably wouldn't even make me feel bad. But that's not what I'm living for. I'm living for Him. And this is His word to me. Be not weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not.
And I'm not even really looking for it in this world. Because whatever I win in this world will stay in this world.
See, God says, you know what? For those of you, you preacher boys, who needed the applause and the glory of men and you got it, that's all you get. When you get to heaven, you get no applause, no glory from Jesus because you got it down here. You poor folks who worked in obscurity and you never got the standing ovation, the Father will give it to you when you get there. Like Stephen, when he was being stoned and he saw Jesus stand. Wow. To get a standing ovation from Him is much better than the standing ovation from all the world. To be acknowledged by God is better than to be acknowledged by man, because what does that count? People will cheer you today and jeer you tomorrow. Oh, that's another jeerism. There you go, right there. What you do for Christ, that's what lasts. I gave all of my children, my wife and I gave all of our children at an altar one day, our children to God. When they were born, we took them and we laid them in our father, my father-in-law, her father, their grandfather's hand. And he prayed and said, these parents are giving these children to you. Nano sits over there. Mikey sits there. Pretty cake over there. These children we give to you. Guess what? I still have them. Because I gave them to Him. Someday, this earthly family ends. Will I have this earthly family as a heavenly family? That's the important part. I will probably precede my grandchildren into the gates of glory. Guess we'll be waiting at that portal when they walk through. What is heaven to me if my family doesn't go? A lot of people have worked for so much, but they have lost their family. I know preacher after preacher after preacher who will say the same thing. I went here, I went there, I was a missionary to this place, a missionary to that place. But my kids never followed. Oh, we put them up in some boarding school when we went off over to here, and then we put them in a boarding school when we went off over there, and now we're stranger to our children. Who raised your children? Oh, the world did. Did the world do a good job? Oh, sure, because we never see them anymore. Mm-mm. Not me. Not me. When I was praying for my father, I worked hard to see that other fathers were saved. I remember I used to go to the Union Rescue Mission, and I'd preach to those fellows at the Union Rescue Mission, 800, 500, 800 be in the crowd at night. And I would tell them, listen, I was never a drug addict. I was never an alcoholic. That's not me. I don't have one of those stories how God redeemed me out of alcohol, how I was down and out and God saved. That's not my story. But I'm the child of that alcoholic. And Dad, you might be sitting out here tonight and I don't even recognize you. Because the last time I saw you, you were an alcoholic. And Dad, if you're sitting out here tonight, this is what I want to say to you. And I would take them down Romans Road, how that God loved them, sent His Son to redeem them. And Dad, if you're here, I want you to receive Christ as your Savior. And there would be scores of men would come to the altar because they all had sons that they left. And they wanted to redeem themselves back to God so God might redeem them back to their family.
See, that's the good work. That's the spreading the seed. That's the sowing and reaping.
Guess what happened? One day I found my dad. Hadn't seen him in 32 years. I'm 8 years old. He goes out the door. I was 40 years old. He came back in. And I'd always pray and I'd say, Lord, but don't let me find my dad if I can't win them, because I couldn't take that. That Sunday, I preached and my dad didn't come forward. I mean, I preached my heart out that Sunday morning. And my dad sat right there. Didn't move muscle. It was probably the longest, like an hour and a half invitation. Everybody's knees are buckling. So we got home. And as his custom was, we'd have a cup of coffee in the backyard. He would have his cigarette and we'd sit there and have a cup of coffee. And he said, you're probably wondering how come I didn't go forward. He said, let me tell you. And he told me about when he couldn't find us, how he went to Skid Row, Union Rescue Mission itself. And how back in 68, walking up down the streets of LA looking for his family, couldn't find them. He walked into Union Rescue Mission and one of those men led him to Jesus way back then. But he realized how important it was to me, so the next Sunday he walked forward and rededicated his life just so I could have that experience. Whatsoever man sows. I would tell the Lord, Lord, I can't win my dad, but I can win someone else's dad while I'm here. I can't win my dad, but I can win someone else's dad. And Lord, if there's a Christian man next to my dad, I want him to win my dad. I'll win this guy's dad and hoping maybe he'll win mine. And it worked. Because God's not mocked. And if we will not be weary in well-doing, we will. We will. That's his promise. We'll reap if we don't faint. One day I reaped the soul of my mother, who's now in heaven. I reaped the soul of my father, who is now in heaven. My aunts and my uncles, who are now in heaven. Because I didn't grow weary at it. Sometimes I was the only one still standing. Others who had joined me fell away. But God never did. And I can't let the weakness of the flesh and the weakness of those around me determine what I'm going to do. Because this is a promise. This is the encouragement. We will reap if we do not faint. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows.